Lady Tech Soap for no-nonsense protection against germs. Spectrum wants to hear your views. You can SMS at any time during the show. Type Spectrum, leave a space, type in your contribution and name, then send it to 7197. Your views, our interviews on Spectrum, Radio 1 FM 90.
Good evening. Welcome. Spectrum Strike, that's the creation and recognition of cultural institutions enhancing the Uganda. The history of Uganda is in 1905, Uganda, the year of the Toronto and the kingdom. These kingdoms are ancient as they are still enjoying both local and international recognition. Although these kingdoms are fully recognized in Europe, they are not fully politically sovereign because under the current legal regime, they are and despite they actually will consider cultural influence, the Uganda constitution currently recognizes only four kingdoms, which held by traditional or cultural leader. These kingdoms were reinstated under the current NRM region, having been abolished in 1866 by the Nation. Only the Kole kingdom was not restored on grounds that many locals did not like it. The government of Uganda has officially indicated recently that itself in the country that wants to build its culture and territory is still organizing itself in the unit of cultural institution. This government is in fulfillment of the constitution which provides freedom for the Uganda in the practice their culture or if it's not harmful government. Now this has encouraged some tribes to begin asserting themselves, giving birth to a warrior who in their angles see their problem from the cultural institution. And the territories which are regularly administered by the private in the recent past, the war sharp disagreements over the recognition of the Burundi and the kingdom by the government. In the recent memorandum of understanding becoming under the kingdom, it was agreed that this institution should be recognized. We try to ask what value can be benefited from the creation and recognition of more cultural institutions based on the law of the respective guests. Professor Jim Bach, lecturer at Faculty of Foreign Affairs, to also legal advisor.
I think cultural diversity is a positive thing because a wealth of knowledge that can be drawn from our diversity. And having about 65 ethnic groups in Uganda, whether they are headed by a king or chief or a council of elders, all have different values, different principles which Uganda can learn from. And ideally, our governance system should actually have been founded on our traditional governance systems in different parts of the country, as opposed to being something that is externally driven. And in terms of creativity, cultural diversity offers different elements of skills and knowledge that we, to a large extent, have not exploited, but is potentially valuable to us as a
country. What do you mean that we could have used our governance of traditional
governance? For instance, in the area of traditional governance, one of the things that we have explored as an organization is the value of the way conflicts are resolved at community level, and the emphasis that is placed on reconciliation and compensation as opposed to determining who is right and who is wrong. Most traditional systems go beyond that and see how individuals who are either wronged or who have felt that they have been wronged can be reintegrated into society, so that it is not just punitive measures that are emphasized, but also how do we continue to live in harmony despite the fact that what has happened might be offensive. However great.
We probably live for that beyond the conflict.
It's
all about management of society. How well they can.
I'm not necessarily saying that they are better, but they are better rooted because, for instance, the language that is spoken identifying what is wrong in society. For instance, if I give an example of some work that we did on culture and governance, many of the remarks or comments that we got from people who are interviewed is that traditional systems are known to them. The legal system has so much technology and terminology that is foreign. There is the procedure is foreign. You don't speak for yourself. You're spoken for by a lawyer, and the lawyer has to be paid. In the traditional system, you speak for yourself. You present your problems and are able to negotiate for whatever is to come. So it's a punishment or a compensation. But in the other system, it's actually out of your hands.
The technocrats, Professor, how has Uganda benefited from this culture?
I believe that it will actually have benefited more than it has. And at the moment I know that this is a very policy. There is a provision that in primary school, the students should, for the first 4 or 5 years, learn from their mother tongue. This is very important because especially students feeling that just learning any time. But unfortunately, this has not been systematically implemented. And I think that what is being emphasized today in our religious, rather in our religious institutions, is the use of English, which is a foreign language. I think English is a second language rather than the first language, which is first language.
English should be a second language.
Yes.
So you said mathematics in Uganda.
Definitely,
but physics and physics
in Uganda. Definitely, yes. The point I'm making is that the first mastery of speaking, written,
well, I mean, how much business can you transact in Uganda? Let's be honest. The children are not studying Uganda. How much will you transact?
Well, that's not the point. How many people speak English in Uganda? I'm sure there are probably about 10% that people are transacting in business. So I think we must it's important because if you look at other countries, they want to transact their business in other people's language. Okay? Other people's passions, even if they don't use, they transact their business in their own language.
learn better, especially as a child, if you learn in your own language. Retention from some of the work that we've done and the use of local languages and in the lower primary, I've revealed that the young children retain knowledge better, are more confident, are better able to share their homework and the knowledge that they've gained in school with their parents who probably have not had the opportunity to go to school. So in terms of supporting the young people and for them to explore knowledge which is even outside the classroom, being able to learn in the local language is actually more motivating for them to learn than if they were to learn in English, when they first have to understand the English language and then understand the English language.
Well, maybe they should have the right language. And then learn English.
Well, I think that is what is the situation now, is that you are brought up and you learn your vernacular at home. And then you can't use it at school because you'll be punished because you're speaking vernacular, you're supposed to speak English. But then at a younger age, if you speak English at school, then you're not able to use that English unless you are in an education sort of space. So when you come out into the community, you want to learn about trees and plants and medicine and anything that has to do with our tradition, it's not being in your dictionary or in the school text. Then there is a disconnect between what you're learning and the body of knowledge outside the four walls of the school.
What was the contribution of Kaj for these students to learn as well? We can take the population.
Yes.
They presented power centers that seem to be out of the control of central government. And at that time, central government was not really able to tolerate the pockets of different mini countries, mini nations within the nation. So the idea was to concentrate power in the center, and the cultural institutions and kingdoms were actually interfering in that agenda because they did not necessarily pay allegiance to the center.
Let's actually find some of the things that we can do. Either that came or the almost absolutely. Like this is a discussion, which means that what was passed in the we had the people who were and we tried to do the how was that going to be?
I think in the modern Uganda, it is difficult to visualize it other than the situation which is now, because Uganda doesn't stand alone as a nation. It is by virtue of the way Uganda has been constructed, is part of the rest of this country. So you cannot imagine that it can operate as an autonomous body. Because if that was the case, then you'd have the federalist situation where each kingdom has its own government and it has its own resources and it's independent. But that is not the case. So, and the thing is also Uganda doesn't represent the rest of Uganda. Uganda doesn't represent the rest of Uganda. So the other ethnic groups in Uganda don't necessarily represent the rest of Uganda. So in that way, it's naturally have to be assimilated.
This is the John Rick Lantan. Does that tradition, that recognition of cultural institutions then assimilated as Professor Jim, lecturer at the Faculty of Women's Studies, he also did that as Vivanya for the Cultural Foundation. Also, he's heading it on the executive editor at the Cross Cultural Foundation. It's very good. Professor, why did he celebrate this talk?
That is a very interesting and I think you could ask me one could say there are maybe objective reasons and also subjective reasons. President Hussein was forced to stop the violence. He was betrayed by the government. He was convicted from South Africa again.
And at the same time, probably not have him as the particular leader and how we relate to a king and submit to a king was something we maybe didn't want to consider. But also having a parallel structure within the country where you have the president and his overall authority, and then where he comes from, you have the people of the coalition, which is actually much more powerful than him. I think it was actually it would be a bit difficult to handle because then he would us.
But the president is above all kings.
He is above all kings, but culturally you come from somewhere, and when you get to your home, you submit to your cultural identity, and at that point you actually not the leader. And there is another leader who you need to submit to, and maybe that was not a position you wanted to submit to.
Some kids came, they were strong, they had some, they were fighting, 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 they were f
the issues in the tactics, apart from superior technology, they also use the divide and rule, and I think this is what the area between the Bureau and Uganda Kingdom. In fact, they are credit. Both Kabalega and Mwanga tried to make common cause to fight the British, although unfortunately they were betrayed by a few of the Uganda generals.
Let's take a break. This is Spectrum Radio.
Germs in this house, gather around this radio and listen well, because I will only say this once. You germs, I have seen how miserable you make life for our children. They go in here and hazardous, and you set to play on the injections. I am Kabudeme, and I am here to tell you that when I come into this family, you will be over. I will cover their skin with a double air protection that will destroy you. I will make your eyes and remove your energy. I will make you pay.
You have heard it straight from Kabudeme Meditex. For no-nonsense protection against germs, buy Meditex for your family.
This house has been in our family for years. I remember the first time I painted with my father. I must have been about 12 years old, yeah?
What has the poor child done?
Mother joked that I was being punished, but I didn't think of it that way. One thing stuck with me though. I remember Dad saying to me,
when it comes to paint, there's me in your company. You can never go wrong with. I have trust in their products. Quality is unbeatable.
The words stuck with me. And now, as I put the finishing touches on renovating the house, there really is just one option.
When you need quality paint you can trust, look no further than Suddenly. Suddenly, color your world.
We're coming back.
Spectrum on Radio
1F90. Welcome back on Spectrum Smash. That's the creation and the computer price for this. Our guest is Professor Jim Biden, lecturer at the Faculty of Law and University, one of the associate advisors of the Ghanaian Agricultural Foundation, the Ghanaian Independent Party, for the matter. Also, Ms. Kennedy Ferdy, Executive Director of the Cross Cultural Foundation and the Regular Conduct of the Ministry. Professor Biden, how is the new kingdom? You had kingdoms from I'm very interested in this.
I will start looking for tomorrow. Time in life. 7 days.
Theoretically, it is possible.
But what about
the course? Because
there are,
for instance, the Wen's rule kingdom is a fast. It's the last thing we have to sustain. Because there are tenders. Now, the leader of the proposal as against the done in the 50s and the 60s because they were fighting for the nation. But it is not clear how that can be done. And I think the only answer would be that if there is any genuine, I think the problem of growth that requires the transfer of the leader of the state should be that the people decide on their own what to do, but at the same time,
some of the balances of the practice.
So they, yes, so they need to strike a balance amongst very important factors. One is to strike a balance between the question of the legitimacy. Where what's the genesis of the British Constitution? And who are they representing? Is it a small group of leaders, or is it actually the master community? And then also they need to strike a balance between preserving heritage and fronting a particular cultural identity, or is it about, for instance, looking at land and natural resources which are within an area which they might call their territory. And of course, because currently I think many of the cultural institutions are not necessarily well-resourced. Economic benefits and you know, value is seeming to take forefront.
Some have put some.
Yes, and now when you're talking about oil, are we interested in heritage, which is in the oil, rich areas, or are we interested in how much economic benefit we can get from natural resources like oil, which has suddenly appeared in our area of
influence?
Yes, and I think also trying to create a balance between the position that they hold when they are when they're faced with a situation where a small cultural institution merges within a bigger one. So for instance, if they're in Uganda and emerges, or if you are in Toro and the council come up, how do you deal with that and you know, set an example of how to engage or not engage with diversity? Because just as Uganda as a country was striving for independence, and then you have Toro also striving for independence, and then you have the Bakonzo, and now you have the Wazabindi, and the other groups also saying, we would like to be recognized for our cultural identity. Recognizing that and embracing it is really difficult. And they have no point of reference because this hasn't happened before. So I think creating a balance between wanting to be recognized and allowing others to be recognized just the same way is a challenge which traditional institutions are facing. And there is no clear way in which this is handled in the balance.
Professor, but how, what are the benefits of cultural leaders that we need to find?
Well, in the indigenous society in Uganda, I think that the example of our Kayuba in the rise of the UBC is still alive. I think that if you want to represent the community, it is important that you try and stand above parts of the UBC. However, this does not mean that they should have no. If there is education, I think that it is important to get a cultural leader. I don't think a cultural leader can hide under the facade of England or something by seeing something wrong and so I think they can play.
What kind of statements are they making? Don't move time.
If I was a cultural leader, and I have made this concentration, and I think this is for this country, what makes this? It is that a cultural leader is a religious leader. If a religious leader sees that it's wrong,
you should talk about it.
I think that by saying that traditional leaders are not religious, I think this is it is a mistake. Because what is pointless? If I say corruption is bad, that is pointless. If I say we need good education, that is actually pointless. And I think the country leaders should be able to take some of these things. I think what is problematic is it is when a cultural leaders are human, not directly related to them, support divisive effort. And I think this is where, at least for the time being, until we get maybe a different framework in which they can operate, I think this is where they should work directly because that is highly visible. But to start from a point, or to say this is right and this is wrong,
Spectrum, how about you?
may have ended up being very interesting. In the short term, this is sort of the restoration of criminals and getting them easier. There have been very many demands for Uganda in 2022. The local inclusion, and the NRM was saying, we did not have the store, we did not fail the store. That was the real position of the NRM. There was also an Ember Council meeting in Kuru, in which the president persuaded a struggle, I think, in general regional affairs, in fact, this paper in the end was saying, no, don't restore the NRM. But the very final session of the NRC that restored, that would restore criminals, was closed. So, in a bad atmosphere, I think we should assess our history. Honestly, so, I think there was pressure. But as I said, in spite of that pressure, we can have some positive things in the restoration of some of these institutions that are popular in their areas.
Yes, he says that some of them have been used to the state.
Give an example. But you see, these institutions are at the intersection between culture and politics. And therefore, whatever you say, they definitely have a political role. And each community has some aspirations. And I think that the main aspiration of the people of Uganda has been something. And I think that would be the more focal. For the question of style. But otherwise, the demands from men, irrespective of the condition, have been the same.
Can you answer one?
Well, I think the challenge that we face is drawing a line between what is called power, which is partisan power, and then the power which controls leaders with. And often, traditional institution has its own aspirations and these are in conflict with what is seen as the political agenda, then they are seen to be fighting government, as opposed to saying that they will always be divergent views, they will always be people who have different aspirations and they have the right to be able to articulate those aspirations that they have. And it is the role of the state to see how we can embrace those different aspirations of the people who are in Uganda and create an agenda that is resonates with what people want, as opposed to seeing any view that is different to be seen as a fight against the state.
Will another leader who comes after our leader destroy that one?
I think the restoration of the Akoli Kingdom really lies in the heart of the people. And if that is what they want, and what form is that going to take? Are they restoring the kingdom as it was before, which many people would see as a
present? Which one is yes,
and you know, not many, and as we have heard, they have a caste system, the people don't go back to a system where you are subjected to a certain status in society. Or do you want a situation where all the Akoli are recognized as equal citizens, as equal subjects, if you like, of their kingdom? So if you were to say they restore the kingdom, what moment that would be? And now they have a choice, because as we know, there are some wealthy, I don't call it Bible, but there are some wealthy people who in the past were considered as the lower people who will never rise.
And they have
some of them. That's not the issue. I think, as I said, you want to restore that as well. But I think that if you propose that something more criteria that was, for instance, under one, probably those who want to restore it will protect it. So I am saying that. He's right, he's not a good boy. And if there is a vote on the platform, the one at the end of the day may be restored. just mentioned.
After I enjoy legitimate risk.